Hi, I'm Fumita Rashid, Senior Writer at CSO Online. Today, I'm with Wendy Nather, Principal Security Strategist at Duo Security. We're going to talk about how we have a tendency to blame people for not doing security right. And I think Wendy's going to point out just how complicated that statement really is. So Wendy, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So as I was just saying, you know, there's always a bit of, oh, why aren't people patching? Why aren't people doing this? If you only did this, we wouldn't have a breach. And you said recently that it's not quite that simple. So I was hoping you can tell us a bit about that.
Yeah. And you know, armchair CISOs really bug me. If you've ever worked in an enterprise and you've actually had to figure out how to make security work, you'll know that if you pull on any kind of thread, you will discover behind it a reason why something is the way it is. And then when you ask why that is, you pull on another thread and you find another reason. And it all goes back to something that makes perfect sense at the time, almost all of the time. And maybe those reasons don't apply anymore, but, you know, for example, take the public sector. They have a problem of constraints in that we as taxpayers don't want to pay for anything more that we don't have to. So if a server's working just fine, they're not going to approve any money to upgrade it.
I was actually thinking about that if anybody even tried from the state government saying, oh, we need brand new computers, I can hear the outcry. What do you mean? Why can't you just use the computers you have right now? I'm not going to pay for that.
Exactly. You know, if your desk is working just fine and they say, no, we have to update it, you know, every Tuesday, the first Tuesday of the month, we got to roll it out and bring you a new one. Or somebody's always coming in and going, oh, wait, there's something wrong that we forgot to fix. Let's just fix that. It becomes annoying, and even if they put wheels on it to make it really easy to roll in and out, you're still going to be annoyed because it's like, you know, my desk is working fine, please, I want to get back to work. So there are so many reasons behind that and constraints. We won't even get into medical devices that were built to last. They were built to last for 10 to 20 years. They cost that much money, you know, millions of dollars for a whole suite, that you're not going to just swap it out all the time. So there are a lot of things behind that. But what bugs me even more is that a lot of the comments that we make about these organizations and their users reduce down to one of three things. They're either saying, kind of implying that they're stupid. You know, we've been telling them this for 20 years. Why are they not getting it? Yeah. Or they're saying that they're lazy. Oh, it's just not a priority. If they were, you know, could just
they cared about security, they would do it. Exactly.
So, you know, they imply that they're lazy, or they imply that they're evil.
Right.
You know, well, they're you know, their motivations are just not in the right place. They don't care about their customers. No, they actually do. They care so much more that security is just a little tiny blip on their radar, because keeping the customer's business is so much more important. Mm-hmm. If you look at something like the hospitality business, mm-hmm. everything around what they do is geared towards the customer experience.
Right.
And
not slowing
if anything
down.
Threatens that,
yeah.
You know, that is their top priority. I hate to break it to security people, but security is not their priority.
Yeah.
It is to a certain extent, and especially at Black Hat right now, there will be people walking the floors that, you know, belong to MGM and the Mandalay Bay, and they are on top of the security game. You won't notice them, but still, the guest experience is paramount.
Right.
So we have to understand all of these dynamics that play into what organizations really do care about.
So one of the things you've mentioned when we talked about this was, again, there's many things they're caring about, security not one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And you said maybe security shouldn't be something, not that they should be doing, but maybe we're asking them to do more than they should be.
I think so, and I think actually we may see a pushback in the future from users and organizations that say, wait a minute, you know, these things are insecure as all get out, and that, you know, we're getting breached all the time, and this is our fault, why? So, you know, they want things that just work, and just work includes just being secure or being secure enough.
Right.
So we may see a user revolution coming along where people who are used to their consumer experience of electronics and their phones and tablets and everything being really, you know, top notch.
Right.
But when they go into work and suddenly there are all these weird rules and they're using outdated equipment and they're going, you know, wait, why are we doing this?
Exactly.
And I think it's both are issues here. You know, when you have a hospital, they're making their purchasing decisions on, okay, if you do the math, in 10 years we would have paid off this equipment.
Yeah.
And then we're telling them, oh yeah, but by the way, that can't be updated. Mm-hmm. So in 3 years, that's going to be obsolete equipment. That shouldn't be the fault of
right.
the hospital. That should be the vendor, the manufacturer, who said, okay, we should be doing this differently.
Yeah, and they are, you know, now. I mean, there are a lot of organizations and groups, including I and the Cavalry, that are working with these manufacturers to, you know, help them understand the way things are now. And that's great. But what do we do about the legacy equipment?
So how extensive is the legacy equipment and the entire, oh, they don't care? Is that a small minority? Is that something that doesn't even exist? And they're like the bogeyman? Like, how did that kind of fit in there?
Well, I would be willing to guess that the majority of organizations that have legacy infrastructure can't even afford to come here to Black Hat. So we are never going to see those people. They're
we're
quietly
not even talking to them.
Yeah, they're quietly keeping the lights on, and those are real heroes out there. And you never hear their stories unless you go on site and they trust you and they tell you about them.
Right.
But I've just heard so much about amazing things that people have put together with, you know, shoestrings and duct tape to keep security up and running. But we're never going to hear their stories on stage here.
Exactly.
And would you say that the ones who are getting the shoestring, duct tape, maybe a wad of gum,
yeah.
are these the ones?
Cyber gum.
Are these the ones who are essentially just using the basic tools and figuring it out? Or are these actual tools that maybe are being independently developed outside of the expo halls?
Yeah, it's both. I know a lot of really, really large organizations that end up building their own mm-hmm. just because they have very specific needs, including scalability, but other
right.
things that the vendors just can't keep up with. And then at the SMB end, you do have people who are writing their own tools because they can't afford anything.
Right.
In between, it's a big mixture. Mm-hmm. But again, those people are not here today. They're back in their offices
keeping
that stuff
on.
Running.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the last question I want to kind of take away from this conversation is, we talk about how security is complex. We talk about how it's a two-way street. Everybody needs to be kind of listening and seeing, okay, what are you doing? How can I help you? But just saying that, okay, stop doing this, do it this way, is not resonating.
Mm-hmm.
So is it that the method needs to change, or is it that we actually need to tell them different things to do?
Well, or we need to stop relying on them to do the things and rebuild the infrastructure so they don't have to worry about it.
Okay, so that kind of goes back to what you were saying about the consumer one. Like, if we're making it auto update or we're making it so that it's self-healing, then you don't need to worry about what they have, whether or not they've applied the patch.
Yeah, exactly. Because we're telling people, you know, I mean, the web is all links. It's all for clicking. And then we say, well, don't click those. What's wrong with you? There are so
That's
many
true.
Things that we, you know, tell them, you can do all these things with your program, but oh my God, don't do that.
Right.
It's like, you know, turn off your macros in Office. Well, they're there for a reason, and they're very useful, especially,
exactly.
you know, on the financial side. Who are we to tell them, oh my God, stop using them because they're not safe?
Right.
It's like, well, why don't you make them safe? Because I got work to do.
Exactly.
Which, right, we gave them the features, and then we said, oh, you shouldn't be using it.
Yeah.
And then we said, what's wrong with you? How can you not know, you know, to stop using that?
Right.
So, yeah, if it were as simple as saying, okay, we're going to need you to not, then that would have worked 20 years ago.
Right.
And so I realized that by saying this now, saying to people, I need you to not tell them to not, it's not going to work any better.
Yeah.
But, you know, we just have to learn from the changes that are not happening the way we want them to and think, well, maybe the problem is us and we should examine it more closely.
Wendy, thank you so much for joining me today. Every time we talk, I learn so much and I really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
So, for more news about Black Hat 2017, please join us on idg.tv and CSO Online.